Hello and welcome to the White House 1600 Sessions. I'm Stewart McLaurin, President of the White House Historical Association. Today, we're fortunate to be on the gorgeous grounds of the Oak Spring Garden Foundation in Upperville, Virginia. Oak Spring was once the estate of American philanthropists Paul and Rachel Lambert Mellon. Mrs. Mellon, known by her nickname Bunny, and her husband, they traveled in affluent circles, as you would imagine, and they were friends to both the Kennedys and the Reagans. Mrs. Mellon was known for her exquisite style and incredible taste. She was also known for her love of gardening and her passion for landscape design. And that is why we're here today. Mrs. Mellon's grandson, Thomas Lloyd, is a friend and a member of the Association's National Council on White House History. And he's also a keeper of his grandmother's legacy, having co-authored several books about Mrs. Mellon, including Garden Secrets of Bunny Mellon and Bunny Mellon Style. Well, Thomas has been kind enough to invite us here to Oak Spring to talk about his grandmother's most famous project, which he was asked by President John F. Kennedy personally to reinvent the White House Rose Garden, which was completed in 1962. The space known as the Rose Garden has gone through several incarnations prior to the Kennedys' time and has undergone smaller renovations in the decades since. Most recently, in 2020, the Rose Garden underwent its first major renovation in almost 60 years under First Lady Melania Trump to address issues of drainage and irrigation, as well as some older growth of mature plants there and the wear and tear on the grounds. Well, Mrs. Mellon always said that the nature of gardens is that they never remain the same. They are living things. And that's what we've seen at the White House, and that's what we can see as a prime example of that here at Oak Spring. Just take a look at the incredibly luscious landscape around me and these acres of land. You could spend hours in these gardens and keep discovering something new and exciting. And that's exactly why President Kennedy selected Mrs. Mellon to design an American garden for the White House, one that would rival the gardens of European palaces that he had seen on his travels abroad. Well, this is a truly exciting day for me and for all of you, I hope, and we're so glad that you joined us for this special episode. So Thomas, here we are in your grandmother's home at Oak Spring, and the walls of this house have to just reverberate memories from your childhood and knowing her. Tell us about the history of this house and memories of you growing up with your grandmother here.
Certainly. Well, I mean, some of my earliest memories were coming here for Thanksgivings and Christmas times. You know, you would not be able to just run into the front door. Someone would usually meet you, and you'd make your way to the living room, and we would spend a fair amount of time with my grandmother just talking about exciting things that we wanted to do. We went down to her house in Antigua, or talking about the upcoming summer at the Cape. But she just would always want to engage with my brother and I in understanding, you know, what our interests were. And she would always ask questions about us. It was rarely did she talk about herself. And, you know, that was something that I wish at a younger age I could dig more out of her than I did. But, sure. Here we are.
And it has to bring her back to you even when we're here today.
It does. Yeah, absolutely. And again, as I've gotten older, and being able to really look at the massive amount of correspondence that she was able to leave behind, it's given me a pretty vivid picture of her as a person, you know, not just the public persona that we all get to know. And for me, being able to share that with many, including yourself, is just a pleasure.
Well, this is a place that also would have been familiar to Mrs. Kennedy and the memories that they would have had in their relationship. And Mrs. Mellon was known as an icon of style and design. How did that evolve in her own life? Who influenced her? And then who did she influence as a result of that?
Well, I mean, I think very much, both in art and in actual aesthetics, she was a Francophile at heart. She loved all things French.
And that she had in common with Mrs. Kennedy, for
that's
sure.
Exactly right. And I mean, we're all familiar with her friendship with Balenciaga and Givenchy. She clearly had a number of people who could aid, but they were really collaborators and friends of hers. And there's no doubt that she and Jackie were able to relate on a number of levels.
Well, your grandmother was a lady of style, and yet she was not above getting her hands dirty, literally. How did gardening become so important to her, and what place did it have in her life?
Yeah, well, I think it first and foremost served as a creative platform for her. You have to remember that she graduated from sort of finishing school. She went to Foxcroft and approached her father and asked to go to college. She wanted to be a set designer. And her father said, no, you're going to get married. And so I think gardening represented a creative output initially for her. And it really then became a place for her to really adapt all of these ideas in ways that she just treasured. And she taught herself everything that she did out in her garden. So,
well, we were about 40 miles west of Washington, out in the idyllic Virginia countryside of rolling hills. And just driving out here today, I can just feel my blood pressure going down. And it's such a beautiful setting here. And she must have spent part of every day in these gardens, as beautiful as they are.
Every day, at least 12 hours a day. In fact, there was a funny story about Babe Paley, who was a good friend of hers. And Babe had just bought a house in the Hamptons and wanted to invite herself down to Oak Spring to learn how to garden, because she was not a gardener. And came down, and my grandmother basically had lunch with her and said, Babe, you know, you've got to be out working every day. You can't be doing these lunches. And so she tried it for a couple days and just said, this isn't for me. You know, please send your gardeners up. So my grandmother did. She was out 10 to 12 hours a day. She made it her life's work.
Well, I love the title of the book that you have been a part of, Garden Secrets of Bunny Mellon. It's a really terrific book, and I hope everyone watching us today will pick this up. But I have to ask you, give us a couple of the key secrets.
Sure. This was part of sort of uncovering all of the letters that she had kept. There were a number of letters that she sort of referenced an idea of what she would do if she was ever going to write a gardening book, and it was just tips. And, you know, first and foremost, I think the first part was the integration of the land with whatever architecture that you're building has to be in scope and purpose. And the other parts were just shadows. She would take many pictures with different props and just see how the shadows fell before she would even plant anything. And those were the two initial, you know, sort of secrets that she would use with gardens, was really understanding light fixtures with, you know, walls versus the parterres. And, you know, before you planted anything, you had to make sure that the bones were there.
Well, she contributed a wonderful article that she wrote to a former issue of our White House History magazine about the White House garden. Did she ever write a book, though?
No, she never really, I think, recorded, other than what she had personally, about her own experiences doing this. I think it would have been a very interesting project that no doubt she would love to do, and that's why I think a lot of people have really tried to capture what that story is like.
Would she be surprised at the emphasis on her legacy with the White House Rose Garden and gardening in general?
Well, I think she would certainly not be used to the amount of praise. She was never one to accept and promote herself. So I think it would be a little jarring for her in this day and age. But no, I think it's wonderful the kind of respect that she deserves is being shown today.
Well, the friendship that she had with the Kennedys, and it was a friendship, it was just not a transactional endeavor to design this rose garden. When did she meet them, or how did she come to know them, and which one did she meet first?
She met Mrs. Kennedy first, and it was through a mutual friend of theirs, Adele Astaire, who was living in Upperville here, said to Jackie, who was, again, part of their family, extended family, you need to meet Mrs. Mellon. And of course, Jackie, at that point in time, was not the first lady, but was familiar with my grandmother. And as the story goes, she came out here to Oak Spring for the first time and had lunch and took rigorous notes, both visual and by hand, and went home. And then a week later, my grandmother receives this just beautiful letter, handwritten letter from Jackie, just sort of outlining all of the wonderful things about her home, even down to the parts of just stale candies in little bowls that she thought were so charming. And she just said, you know, all of that is so much better than what anything I have at my house. So please let me just, you know, ask your opinion. And that really, I think, established their relationship. And, you know, you move forward into the 1960, 1961, where she and her husband have a place up in Cape Cod, and Jack comes over, and that's where the first conversation about the Rose Garden occurs. So, you know, they also had a very close relationship, but really, Jackie and my grandmother, there was no closer friend to my grandmother than Jackie.
So at that time, the Kennedys were living in Georgetown. He was a United States senator, and she was a young senator's wife in her 20s. And I think she involved your grandmother in that home of theirs, didn't
yes.
she?
No, she absolutely, I think after coming over here, wanted very much as much attention toward her house and asked my grandmother to put her magic touch as well, as you would say. And she certainly did offer up and helped with many design elements of her house moving forward.
Well, the impetus for the Rose Garden, the Kennedys had been abroad and they come back and they go up to Nantucket, and this presentation is made to your grandmother about doing this garden. But she wasn't a gardener that had her shingle hung out, "I will come design your garden." This was an unusual thing for her to undertake, wasn't it?
Very much. I mean, she was, again, she didn't go to any formal school for this. Mm-hmm. Again, the Kennedys just coming back from their experience in France, and, you know, the president very much understanding that he loved the gardens that he had experienced, wanted something similar, and my grandmother's affinity for France and her style, I think, fit. And I had no hesitations in just presenting, almost demanding that she was going to be the one to come up with a plan. And my grandmother really couldn't say no.
Clearly, the relationship lasted beyond the relationship with the president, and they went on to be friends for many, many years. Do you know or have any recollection of your grandmother speaking about the death of President Kennedy and the funeral itself?
I don't have any direct remembrance or conversations that I can recall directly with my grandmother. She, again, I think, allowed herself a lot of sort of walls to be placed up. But I do know that, you know, during that period of time, especially when she went to Martin Luther King's funeral, there's a lot of reflection on just sadness and again, the turmoil that was a part of that period of time in this country.
Well, at the time of President Kennedy's funeral, I understand that Mrs. Kennedy actually wanted a basket of flowers from the Rose Garden placed at his grave.
She did, yes. And again, I think she created a sort of a very simple wooden cross, presented those flowers. I think she really wanted to make sure that this simplistic nature that I think sometimes people put in her style was reflected very clearly as a warm connecting piece between her family and the Kennedys. And, you know, certainly Mrs. Kennedy appreciated that more than anything. I think it was just that personal touch.
Did your grandmother's relationship with First Ladies and with the White House end with the Kennedys?
No, in fact, it continued on through the Johnson administration. And then, you know, I remember as a young child how she would talk about going over to visit with Nancy Reagan, who called her regularly and, you know, asked for her opinion. So she would certainly, you know, try and consult without, you know, taking too much credit or control. I think it was very hard for my grandmother at times. Sometimes she would want to jump in too much and had to restrain herself because, you know, it's just in her nature. But yeah, she very much was always available, very, very, very much available for helping.
And there was another episode of her helping, and that's when time came to build the Kennedy Library. And she was also involved with that, I understand.
She was, yeah, very much. I think the idea of architecture, the integration of spaces, and how gardens sort of complement those spaces, she was just a master at balancing those two. And the relationship that she and Jackie and, you know, Jackie's children and our family, I think that again, was all part of why my grandmother continued to be an influence in a lot of these decisions that were made based around what happened after the president passed away.
Well, certainly she was had a front row seat to so much of history in those years, and to know a president and first lady as closely as she did, and to be able to work with them hand in hand to create this new space. It's like creating a new room in the White House, like a new blue room or red room or green room. It's this Rose Garden, and this beautiful canvas of space that she envisioned with President Kennedy. Now, I think President Kennedy had his own ideas, didn't he?
Oh, certainly. And again, I think he was very clear to my grandmother that he wanted to not just have roses. He wanted a number of different colors. Again, taking a lot of what his experiences have been on that trip with Jackie to France. And just again, trying to incorporate a space first and foremost to use this new platform called television. And, you know, to do something that allows for the function as well as the beauty, I think that's really where my grandmother's talents are really appreciated, as she could balance those two in a way that really not only pleased the president, but gosh, I think just, you know, stand the test of time, really.
Well, your grandmother used to famously say, every garden has its own way of being. What does that mean to you?
Well, I think first and foremost, and this is one of her secrets, is you don't really build something from your head. You take sort of note of what the space provides you first. And I think then you have to build and adapt around that. There was never an idea that she could shape something the way she wanted to. She had to shape something around what was given to her and work and adapt with that. So, you know, the White House has a tremendous history, and that Rose Garden space itself had been used and utilized in a lot of different ways. She listened to the president and I think just tried to, as much as possible, create that element that she just was proud of. And she was. She was very proud of it.
As you did this book, and as you reflect on her influence and her legacy relating to gardens, which is so much a part of this place to this day, if you could have some time with your grandmother and walk through these gardens today, what would you talk with her about?
I think I'd want to know more about the relationships that she had that formed the initial interest she garnered in the world of gardening. And, you know, I mean, I know she was very close with her maternal grandfather, Arthur Lowe, who really shaped the interest in the outdoors and the sort of whimsical nature that she had in design. And, you know, just understanding how that mentorship with her grandfather and other people helped at a young age influence this brilliant mind. I think I'd really like to know more about that from her.
And wouldn't she be proud to know that here you are today, sharing her legacy about these gardens and caring about this that she cared so much about?
Well, I can only hope that she would be. I want people to appreciate her as an amazing individual and also just, you know, someone that I think we can all admire in different ways.
Well, we've had a great conversation here to begin talking about the history of the gardens and the design of the gardens, the inspiration, but I understand there's some special archival elements about the designs themselves that you're going to take us to see now. Can we head over there?
Let's go.
Great. So, Thomas, here we are in your grandmother's library, this beautiful space. It has such a serenity and a tranquility to it. And I said when we came in, it's almost like you could feel your grandmother still here or walking in at any moment. What are your memories of this space, and how did she use this library?
Yeah, well, I mean, I think it's important to understand that she was a collector before this library was built. And her husband, Paul, I think at some point in time, and just said, we need to find a place for all of your wonderful books that you've collected over the years. She was quite a pack rat. So they constructed this. Edward Laramie Barnes designed it with my grandmother in mind. And I think it's just a very cozy reflection of a place that she wanted to, you know, house all of the wonderful memories and things that she created over the years.
Well, there are so many special things that are kept here. And before us is one of those elements, a very special drawing. Tell us about this.
That's right. Well, in front of us here, we have a drawn copy of the Rose Garden. My grandmother, as you well know, was asked by President Kennedy to go ahead and move forward in 1961 with constructing a Rose Garden. And mind you, she was a completely untrained horticulturalist, as many would have called her at the time, yet she was able to put together this beautiful rendering of a space that did everything he asked, which was really ultimately serve as a place for him to host and reflect as a platform all the views of what was going on at the time at the White House.
Well, you see, I love down here, it says in her handwriting, proposed plan for President Kennedy, January 24, 1962, and it has the very intricate design along the colonnade of the trees and the roses, and then the beautiful stage that he wanted, the stage area that could act as a place. You know, we're so, our mind's eye is so familiar now with the president coming out of the Oval and stepping onto those stairs, and that had not been there before.
Right,
President Kennedy wanted that, and your grandmother implemented that into the design.
Right, that's true. And again, as you know, the middle step was intentionally created wider than the other two so that he would have that platform to stand. Yes. It's also important, as you know, that it had been a rose garden for many, many previous administrations, and this was just a new iteration of that. And I think the one part that was really difficult for my grandmother when she was initially trying to decide how to design this was, what was going to be the anchor or the borders for the space, which was pretty much unyielding in terms of its design. It really didn't have too many structures to it. So she was traveling down Fifth Avenue in New York, of course, and she saw three magnolia trees outside of the Frick. And she just thought that just clicked. And she came back and told the president, I have figured it out, and began her plan focusing around four magnolias that she took from the tidal basin.
Well, I want to stop there because those saucer magnolias, I'm told, emphasis on took. Now, this may just be lore or story, but I understand that they wanted to go through some protocol and process to obtain them. And at the end of the day, she just sent the Park Service down and took them almost in the dark of night. And they took them from a place where they really weren't noticed or appreciated very much.
Yes.
And brought, and now they had become this, the anchors in the corner of this extraordinary space.
That's correct. Well, I think things were a little bit easier back in the day. And certainly with Mrs. Kennedy's help and support with the president, they were able to, I think, have some flexibility.
And it was really removing from one park to another park because the White House is reservation number one for the National Park Service.
Yes. And, you know, again, outside of those elements, I think the Catherine crab apples that were a part of each structure really created a nice divide between the stark white complex that was the White House with a space that was going to be very open, just grass, to serve as a place for both events and press conferences. So,
and not a bad commute for the president on a daily basis to come out of the White House here and to stroll along the colonnade past this extraordinary garden and into the Oval.
That's right.
Well, there's another something that I want you to share with us, and it's right behind us. So let's take a look at that.
Sure.
It's so amazing to me with this garden and with so many other things that Mrs. Kennedy undertook. As you know, she founded our organization, and she and President Kennedy had every reason to believe they'd be in the White House for 4 years or perhaps even 8 years, but they front-ended so many things that were important that benefited other presidencies following them, including the creation of the White House Historical Association, hiring the first curator, creating what is now the Committee for the Preservation of the White House, and of course, this spectacular rose garden. And then there came a time when a gift was given to your grandmother by Mrs. Kennedy, and that's what we're showing here. And of all the archival elements that relate to Mrs. Kennedy and her years in the White House, to me, this is the most special. Tell us about this.
This is by far one of the most special pieces we have in her library. And I think, as you said, a lot happened with a lot of expectations by Mr. and Mrs. Kennedy, and I think this reflects how a wonderful friendship came out of such very, very dark times for their family. And I think if you look at just the time that Jackie put into something like this over years of very good, hard times, and when she gave it to my grandmother, she presented it to her during Christmas in 1966 at my grandmother's house down in Antigua. And my grandmother was so touched, she couldn't really look at it for a couple of weeks. She was overwhelmed with emotion. And it just, again, reflects, as you said, a relationship that started around the idea of a rose garden and really blossomed into a personal relationship that was the closest for, I think, either one of them over their lifetimes. Mm. I think, as you can see, it's sort of a time where she creates a lot of personal pictures. There are many pictures in here, like this one, that sort of reflect the earlier times of the plans themselves. Right. My grandmother is still, in a lot of ways, recopying over things that she would share with Jackie. And, you know, really what I think is one of the more special items of this story is this part here at the end where she really reflects on the children.
Look at that, the family pictures with the pets. And
that's right. And just again, what she knew that my grandmother gave to President Kennedy, and how you've made it so that he will always be remembered for what will forever be the most beautiful at the White House. So really, through this tragedy, there is a tremendous personal connection that was born and cultivated and culminated over a lifetime between two amazing people.
Throughout the book, of course, the captions for each photo and image are in Mrs. Kennedy's own hand. And then she's drawn some things as well throughout this. So it's really conveying her heart to your grandmother, when she could have easily sent a Tiffany bowl or flowers or something. But we don't know how long it took her to create this. It had to take quite a bit of time.
Oh, years, of course. And just again, the thought behind that, and we take it for granted, but you know, my grandmother, and back in the days when everyone would write letters, this is actually a letter that my grandmother wrote noting her emotions and how she felt when she received this. And again, I think that this is another reason why it's so amazing that we have this collection here at the library that is able to preserve a lot of their thoughts and ideas of how things were going during that very turbulent time. And as you reflected very well, you know, people can see this, but the emotion behind it, I think, is really something that is understated for a lot of people.
Is there something, a sentiment in this letter that is special to you that you would share with us that your grandmother said to Mrs. Kennedy?
Sure. Now, I think a lot of what is written in there, I think the specific note of just how nervous she was to even go through it. I mean, my grandmother was not noted as a nervous person to much or to many. And just to think about, we're all humans, and we have those moments where we're touched, and I think she was just touched. The scrapbook meant so much to my grandmother, and it actually remained in Antigua for many years. When she brought it back here to Upperville, she wanted to obviously protect it. So she designed this beautiful cover, which I think sort of resembles in a lot of ways the colors of what she loved about Oak Spring, and it just has the wonderful rose garden emblem on the end. And there was, I mean, my grandmother could make any cover look beautiful. So
well, that's a work of art
as
well.
I know, really, truly. So, and again, as you said, it really reflects the care and the love of what was, I think, for both of them, their strongest relationship.
Well, it is certainly quite a legacy of the Kennedy presidency to have this outdoor room, which continues to this day. And as you noted, there had been iterations of a rose garden and a garden in that space before, back to when Teddy Roosevelt had the greenhouses torn down that were just west of the White House, and what is now the West Wing was built. And so there have been generations of gardens, but this Bunny Mellon Kennedy Rose Garden was iconic, lasted and has lasted for many, many years. And you know, things happened before this presidency, things happened after that presidency, but this is a gift to the White House and to the country, and this gift from Mrs. Kennedy to your grandmother are all just extraordinary parts and stories from that very short, that tragically too short Kennedy presidency.
That's correct, and I think my grandmother was the first to say in many situations with all of her garden spaces that gardens change, gardens adapt. And, you know, when I think back to how she was approached by the president that day at her house in Cape Cod, she was given a reason to build this garden to serve a specific purpose. And I think that each administration, whether it's previous or ones in the future, will have that same dilemma and that same interest in updating for a purpose something. And my grandmother just had the ability to make things beautiful as well.
Well, I know that President Biden and Dr. Biden use the garden spaces today. In fact, I was in the Rose Garden not long ago with Dr. Biden, and she was reflecting on your grandmother's legacy and Mrs. Kennedy's legacy in what they did all these years ago, 60 years ago now, to create this very special space. Thank you for sharing this.
You're welcome.
Wonderful, wonderful Valentine, really, from Mrs. Kennedy to your grandmother. And the pictures and the stories that it shares and that it captures is really a true part of White House history. So having seen these beautiful depictions of the Rose Garden in drawings, I want to go with you to a space that was very special to Mrs. Mellon, and that's her garden here at Oak Spring. Can we go?
Let's go.
So Thomas, here we are, finally in this extraordinary garden. This is what it's all about. Take me through it.
Yeah, well, again, this was my grandmother's office, her pride and joy for, 70 years. And as you're seeing, something that was developed in the early 1950s, things are still culminating and growing today in ways that we cannot believe. But I'd like to sort of start from the ground up here. As we were sort of talking about, my grandmother would always just let things grow. And as she said, nothing should be noticed. However, this is very intentionally certainly crafted to be noticed in certain ways. So,
and I love the mullein here,
which
is a wildflower.
That's right.
But it looks so exquisitely placed here.
Yes, yes. In fact, there's a story about a mullein that was on the front part of the house that she named Grandpa, which I think is kind of funny.
That's great.
As we're moving down here, there were multiple levels to this garden, which gave it perspective. I think that it was really important. And I wanted to sort of walk over in this direction over here.
Sure.
We have the cornflower over here, which I think also was something that Mrs. Kennedy appreciated
the
very much.
The cornflower was one of Mrs. Kennedy's very favorite flowers.
That's right. And so again, as you can see, just a nice balance of some of the sort of French style espaliers that we have here going across. And the thing that I loved about her gardening was there were different seasons, different colors, but ultimately it wasn't a complex garden. Here we can see some of these are apples. I'm going to move over here. She didn't take herself too seriously. She has her butterfly garden, as we like to say, and each sort of group of areas over here, very much through her influence of her grandfather, Arthur Lowe, look like butterflies. So her whimsical nature was very much still part of her gardening aesthetic. And as we can sort of understand again the materials here that she utilized, all of this was bluestone from the Blue Ridge Mountains, and again going through some of her more sort of favorite flowers are just again wildflowers and also sunflowers. Blue-eyed grass was another one that was very popular. But really what I appreciate was there wasn't this consistent level of perfection. It had to be sort of a blended nature of materials along with a variety of really interesting native plants that she was able to incorporate.
If I were to try to do something like this, it would look disorganized and like a bunch of random flowers. But to this, the way she's done it here and created this, it's like a tapestry, this symphony of flowers that come together. It's just magical out
here. That's right. Well, and I can say as a child growing up, you're sort of looking from a distance and you just see this woman as a conductor in an orchestra might do with a variety of gardeners.
That's right.
Most times she would have up to 30 gardeners a day working in these same areas. So
along with herself.
Yes, very much every day. And so a big operation.
How beautiful this is. Over here.
There's a story over there was a missing piece of rock that a gardener one time replaced, and she got angry because she wanted it open for the chipmunks. So again, thinking about the imperfections, but also she was very practical in understanding the nature that she wanted to preserve and allowing the wildlife to come in and out and use this as a home as well. So, for me as a person growing up, I wasn't a trained gardener and I certainly appreciate it, but for her, this was an obsession, and we're just so blessed to have such a beautiful space.
And look at this just array behind us of extraordinary space. Well, we're about to go into one of my favorite places, and this is the arbor. So Thomas, as we exit the walls and the gates from the main garden, and we're heading toward the greenhouse, we are underneath this extraordinary arbor, which is really one of the most favorite parts to me of the entire estate. Tell us about this and how these arches are formed.
Well, I mean, if you want to talk about an exercise in patience, my grandmother began these crab apples in the mid to late 50s, and it has taken this long for them to create this canopy that is one of the most important and amazing structures of horticultural landscape in our country.
And they're all so happy. If you were to lose just one,
right,
it would ruin the whole thing. But the
That's
entire
correct.
Length is filled with happy crabapple trees.
That's correct. And every season they have different colors. So the other part of this that I love and my grandmother appreciated was the garden never had a day off. There were always different times, the different blooms, that there was always going to be some level of color involved at every season. And in fact, you know, most of the time, especially if it snows in the winter, they would have to actually get up on ladders and knock the snow off of these branches to prevent them from breaking. So a lot of work still goes into taking care of these very, very strong anchored trees, but it's a labor of love.
Wow, and to think that they're well into their 70s.
Yes, yes.
So as we enter the greenhouse, how would she have used this? It's really an amazing complex. This has to be, you know, 150 feet from one end to the other. And it has a water feature all around it. You can hear the bubbling and gurgling of the water. Very soothing.
Yeah. Well, when they built the house, H. Page Cross designed the main house, and she really wanted to create an extension of that. This was her first greenhouse that she ever really constructed for herself. So she wanted to have the water elements. The blue color is very much a traditional, we used to call it bunny blue, that she would just incorporate into a lot of her styles. And you walk into this expansive space here that is, also an amazing structure. This is a place where she would work every single day. And, you know, to many, this is a hallowed ground piece of example of trompe l'oeil art. And it was a very special place for her, but she did work here every single day and utilized every space.
I feel like we're walking into a museum gallery, and the fact that this was a functional working space is really hard to believe.
That's right, that's right. And my grandmother was not one to not have opinions. there are very, very clear stories written about the process. It just took about 2 years worth of work from start to finish, and there were certainly many fights that she had with many of the creators over this, but ultimately she got what she wanted. The important thing here is that all of this color is original. It has not been touched up. And really, we're very blessed because
And in the Washington humidity, that's really incredible.
Yes.
And from this center hub on both wings,
that's right.
What do we have?
Well, we have two areas, and again, she would utilize both of these areas to sort of focus on two of her main most popular elements of gardening, which were her famous topiaries and also her fruit trees. So you would have many sort of lemons and lime trees sort of mixed in with rosemary and crepe myrtle topiaries of all shapes and sizes. And then over on this side over here, she would incorporate many more of her sort of spring flowers, fall flowers as you were coming into season. And you know, again, as the farm grew, many of those were shifted over to other parts of the property, and this became more of a symbolic area. But really, for the first 20 years of her working career as a gardener, this was her space, and this is where she worked and created her laboratory, so to speak.
I have to tell you, I don't want to go back into the city. This is just so idyllic out here. And to stand and look at this arbor again and back up to the house with the gardens and to feel her inspiration and presence. I see it here. I see it still when I go to the White House and go out into the Rose Garden, as you and I have been to the Rose Garden together and seen that space. And it's just so special. And thank you for bringing it to life for us today. And thank you for carrying on your grandmother's legacy and teaching and telling these stories of her relationship with the White House and its history. Thank you very
much. Thank you, Stuart, and thank you again.
It was great being
with you today. Absolutely, and again, I can't say anything more than you haven't already, and my grandmother would very much want you to stay the night if she was here.
I would love that. Well, you, Thomas, are a great friend of the White House Historical Association, and we're grateful for that friendship and support, and this and its story is a wonderful one that I was privileged to tell with you today.
That's
so thanks pleasure. Very much.
Absolutely.
Thank you all for listening and watching today. I've had the great privilege to bring you stories like the one here today since the program began in 2017. You can listen to the dozens of interviews I've done over the years on your favorite podcast provider, or you can watch them on YouTube. Be sure to subscribe so that you never miss an episode. All of us here at the White House Historical Association thank you for your support. When you become an association member, or when you purchase a book or an official White House Christmas ornament, you are helping to fund our education mission through teacher programming, publishing, and even this podcast. You can learn more about our work as a nonprofit, nonpartisan organization by going to our website, whitehousehistory.org. Thank you very much.